Huh?
Yeah.
Get that out of here.
It works, but it's the delay of the speed.
Hey, you guys
the ball to start the game. Gray got the ball to start.
Thank you.
possession.
Great, you need one more.
Oh, I didn't see Ken.
You got it, you got it. Hold on.
Ready for subs.
Up top.
from that message to Johnny.
Everybody collectively held their breath.
Somebody would get notes.
Somebody would be in trouble.
All of them are just the one that is facing. We did all of the fan lights and heated the
for a minute, if that's okay.
Wow.
Well, thanks for coming, everybody. My name is Colton. I'm one of the pastors here at First Baptist. Came here a little over a year ago, so I've never been to, I don't think I've been to, I might have, Mike could correct me. I don't know if I've been to a men's league game before. I might have came last year for those, but this is cool. I'm glad y'all are here. It's been two pretty good competitive games, and so this has been exciting. I know a handful of people on the FBCD Blue team. I don't think I've met anybody on the Victory team, though we did come and tour your guys' church once, look at your kids' facility and things, so you know, I don't know if I've seen any of you there or not, or any of you work at the church or not, but I've been there once. Anyways, my name's Colton, and one of the things that we want to do here as a part of this men's league is more than just play basketball. We want to give it a little bit of a purpose, and so what we kind of want to do during the half times is just give a little bit of a devotional, and I figured since I'm one of the pastors here on staff. Why not tell a little bit about my story, a little bit about who I am and how I came to be here in DeSoto? And so, if you're cool with that, I'll talk for about 5 minutes. My story is, I like to say it like this. A lot of times pastors or people who are in pastoral ministry, they get put on a pedestal, a pretty big pedestal of thinking that we're perfect or we have our lives completely together, which if you ask my wife, that is absolutely not the case. So what I want to do is I kind of want to dispel that myth a little bit and tell you a little bit about me and my story. And hopefully, if you don't have the hope of Christ in your life after hearing my story, maybe through my story a little bit, you can see a little bit of the hope that you can have in Christ in your life. So my story, I don't know if you all are originally from around here, but I grew up near Hannibal, if you know where Hannibal, Missouri is. A little bit of town called Vandalia is where I hail from. The only thing Vandalia, Missouri is known for is having the largest women's prison in the state of Missouri. So ladies, I hope you've never been to Vandalia. But that's really all we're known for. So I didn't, town of about 1,000 people, real small upbringing, but I grew up in the First Baptist Church in Vandalia. And so raised in the church my whole life, was baptized when I was 7. And like probably a lot of our stories, my story might be familiar to you, might be similar to your story. But when I was in junior high and high school, I got caught up in basically the life that a lot of high school, college age students get caught up in. Caught up in the life of seeking affirmation from my peers, wanting to be a yes man, just whatever my friends wanted to do, I wanted to do the same thing. So all of the partying, all of the drinking, all of the chasing women, all of the drugs, all of these things, that was something that my life wanted because that's what my friends wanted. And I wanted the affirmation of my friends. I wanted to be satisfied with my life based off of what my friends were satisfied in, what my friends were doing. And so that's what I pursued. And from junior high into college, junior high into high school into college, that was just what I did. I lived this kind of double life where during the week, under the eyes of my parents, I lived a pretty upright life. And then on the weekends, under the eyes of my friends, I lived a life full of license to do whatever I wanted, to go to all of the parties and do basically whatever I wanted to do with my life. And that basically stayed the same until I was in college. And when I was in college, I got reconnected with some friends who were following the Lord, who loved the Lord, and I really began to see this difference in their life than in my life. And I got really convicted, and I felt really compelled by the Lord that the way I was living wasn't the way I needed to be living. And it was when I was in college that the Lord really spoke to me and showed me that the way of life where I was just pursuing the things of the world, where I was pursuing the things of my friends, where I was finding satisfaction in things that weren't eternal, right? I really saw that as being not a good way to live. I saw it being really unsatisfactory. I found out that all the parties I was going to, I had to keep leaning into it more and more and more because it wasn't satisfying. And so it was when I was in college when the Lord really got a hold of me and was like, hey, Colton, this life that you're leading, it's not good. It's not satisfying. It's not gonna keep you, right? There's something more. I have something more for you. There's something better than all these things that you're pursuing with your life. And it was when I was in college that Jesus just brought me to my knees and was like, this past of yours, right? These things don't define you, right? Your brokenness, your sin, the wickedness in your heart, these things, they don't define you. What defines you is my love for you. That's what satisfies you. That's what needs to be your direction. Like, that needs to be what you center your life on. And it was in college where that became real to me and where really the deep things of the gospel of the good news of Christ really began to take root in my heart in a new way, in a fresh way. And so it was from there on that that those moments in college where God got a hold of me and was like, hey, Colton, you know, this isn't, you don't need to be living your life this way. You need to be chasing me with everything you have. It was from those moments on where God just got a hold of me. And it was there that I ended up going off to, I felt called to pastoral ministry, I felt called to teach other people about the goodness of Jesus that I had found, that Jesus had shown me about himself. And so it was from there that I went off to seminary to learn more about who God is and what he's done. And I mean, you know, years and years and years later, boom, I'm here. But the reality is, the reason why I wanted to tell you this is because so often people who are in positions of ministry in churches, you think that we're perfect or we've always had it all together. And that's just not the case. It's not the case for anybody who's in church. In fact, a lot of times people are like, oh, I can't go to church because I'm too sinful. I'm too broken. One person doing a devotion at Upwards said, saying that you're too sinful to go to church is like saying you're too sick to go to the hospital. It doesn't make any sense. Why would you say that? Why would your brokenness and your sin keep you from finding the hope of Christ that we all can find in Jesus? And so that's what I want to point you towards tonight, is to know that no matter what sin or brokenness might be in your life or in the life of a loved one or in a friend who doesn't know Jesus, there's hope. There's hope in Christ, and that we need to be people who are open to share that hope with others, and to say that the sickness that we have, the brokenness that we have, the sin that's in our life, whether it's, you know, really bad sin like I was in high school and college, or whether it's, you know, sin that we might think is smaller, like it all falls under the umbrella of Jesus's grace and mercy if we put our trust and faith in Him. And so that's what I wanted to share tonight, is to let you know that the goodness of Jesus is better than the things of this world. It's better than the things we might be chasing. It's better than anything that culture or America or whoever it is has to offer you. There's hope in Jesus that can only be found by laying our life down for Him, by putting our faith and that will ultimately satisfy us. Until that happens, we'll just keep pursuing frivolous and we'll keep pursuing meaningless worldly things. And so I wanted to share that with you to let you know that not only are pastors not perfect, but you don't have to be perfect either. And that's good news. That's what's so scandalous about the gospel, is that we don't have to have it all together. In fact, we can't have it all together. But in Christ, we have hope. So I wanted to share that with you tonight and let you know that we as a church here at First Baptist, we love you and we care about you, and we hope that you come to have hope and faith in Jesus too. So thank you. Let me pray for you. God, we love you. Thank you so much for this men's basketball league. I pray that through our competition, through the games that are played here, that yes, we would be competitive and we would score baskets and run up and down the court, but we would also find a little bit of more purpose for what you have for our lives, a little bit more about the hope that you have for us. So I pray that yes, this league is fun and we build relationships, but the most important thing is that our relationship with you would grow stronger. We love you, Lord. These things we pray in Christ's name. Amen. Amen.
It was a three. It was a three. Number seven.
Thank you.
at a little nine.
My banner's too slow.
Are you on?
Hey, thank you. Head up!
Thank you.
Timeout, Greg.
One minute on the clock. Yeah, I've got a score of 14.
I have a minute.
He's got 2 points this half. Wow. He's got a total of 14 points all year. Yeah, that's his third one. Yeah. He was a good high school player.
Subs.
Got it.
there.
Stop.
still have a timeout. You want to use it. Timeout.
Yep.
Timeout.
Oh, he's got time this second half. Mr. Valley, how's your uncle on deck?
What?
Huh?
His dad's out here playing. They do,
Huh? I thought that was a regular clock. I was like, hey man, we had time out.
Austin Valley?
Sorry. I haven't seen Austin in a while, though.
I can't get that screen to work.
He does. Same height, same size.
Blue. Yeah, they got ball. Yeah. Okay, blue ball.